see enough to realize that it was a man-made thing. Hard thumping. I moved closer. It was an airplane propeller. I almost let out a yelp of delight. But I kept the mouthpiece between my lips. I zeroed in on that propeller and I looked around me. It wasn't hard to find. It lay there what was left of that plane and all around it schools of fish were moving. My hands made motions, the fish scattered, and then I was fumbling around in what was left of a proper-built aircraft. I didn't give a hoot about the plane. I was after the loot. And loot I found, in two big boxes that were so heavy I could hardly budge them. So I tied a cord to them, inflated a balloon attached to that cording, and let it go. Then I swam for the boat. Simon was leaning over the railing, staring into the waters as I came up. His face lost its look of worry as I popped to the surface. I gave him a thumbs up signal, then reached for the hand he extended to pull me aboard. Something hit the deck and splinters flew. I spat out that mouthpiece and dove for the shelter of the cabin. Simon was only a little behind me, but as he toppled into the cabin, his hand darted out and closed around his rifle. His face was grim, his eyes cold. Rifle in hand, he slithered out onto the deck. I watched him. I watched the mountain towering off to one side. Sunlight glinted on something on that mountain. Holding the binoculars to my eyes, I scanned the region where the glint of sunlight had been. I called out to Simon. He's up there, beyond that stretch of gray rock. I see it, Simon called back. He put the stock of his high-powered rifle to his shoulder. He squinted along the barrel, lining up the sights. Then he fired. That gun made a good awful noise. It almost shattered the eardrums. But I saw that glint of sunlight disappear. I didn't know whether Simon had scored a hit. I didn't think so, not at this distance, on the first try. But whoever was up there now knew he didn't have a couple of clay pigeons to fire at. We could shoot back, and Simon did. He put a pattern of shots in and around where the glint had been, and then we waited. There was no return fire. Goddamn bastards, I muttered, feeling a flood of fury rising up inside me. I wanted to be up there, not down here. I wanted to hold my gold cup cold in my hot little cock, and I wanted to let down the hidden rifleman and four points on his body. I turned and studied the waters of the Aegean Sea. I made out the yellow balloon floating there on the water, where it was pointing out the side of that plane wreck. I wanted to get over there, lift those two boxes, and get the hell out of here. Well, why not? My hand reached to the automatic starter. In seconds the motors were throbbing with power. I heard Simon call out in surprise. Get in the cabin, I yelled. I'm going after that treasure, in the hell with that guy up there. Simon ran, ducking into the shelter of the cabin and giving me a long, slow look. You want us to get killed? I was steaming. I gave him one furious glance, then I gave all my attention to the boat. I brought it around in a slow curve to just about where that yellow balloon was floating. Nobody up there can shoot at us down here, not at that angle. We're in too near the shore. Now, give me some rope with which to tie up those boxes. Ropes in hand, I topped over the side of the boat and went downward. The water closed in around me. I used my legs to carry me down. The two boxes seemed to spring up at me. I took my time. I made certain the ropes were attached before I jerked on one of them. Simon began to pull. It was hard work, so I got under each box as it was lifted upward, one at a time, until it was at the side of the boat. Then I got into the